Okay, so we can start on time the first session of this conference. And the first speaker is Hugo Cardoso, who is one of the organizers, but I will not avoid to present him, to introduce him. He is an investigador auxiliar at the Center of Linguistics of the University of Lisbon, and among his publications, I would like to highlight two edited volumes. One is titled Language Endangerment and Preservation in South Asia, published in 2014 by University of Hawaii Press. And the second one, which is particularly relevant to this session, is a volume he has co-edited also with Mario Piñaranda Nunes and other colleagues, and is titled Ibero-Asian Creoles, Comparative Perspectives, published in 2012 by John Benjamin's Publishers. And Hugo's speech today is titled Glimpses of the Lost Asian Portuguese Creoles in Hugo Sukar's Archive. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the very kind introduction. I will be speaking in English because that's the language I've prepared the materials in, but of course if you want to have the discussion or if anything is not clear, then we can also speak in Portuguese later on. So this presentation is a little specific. So last year, for those of you who attended the conference in Lisbon, what I did was to give an overview of what the so-called Asian Portuguese Creole languages tell us about the diffusion of population and you know, the historical processes of the Portuguese expansion in the East. So that was a general overview. Today I'm going to be looking at what there is still to be found in particular archives about these languages, which aren't as well known as they should be, even though, you know, our knowledge of them is increasing by the day. And specifically, I will be talking to you about what can be found in the private archive of Hugo Schuchart. And Hugo Schuchart, a German linguist from the 19th century, he is credited with being, let's say, the initiator, the father of Creole studies, and one of the precursors of contact linguistics. He was indeed the first person to have an encompassing scientific approach to Creole languages in the late 19th century. And interestingly enough, even though, you know, for those of you who know something about the Portuguese-based Creoles of the world, you probably know that the best-known ones and the ones that have received more attention are the ones of the Atlantic, right, the islands of Cape Verde, Guinea-Bissau, Saint-Thomé. This is where the focus has been, as in general, Creole languages of the Atlantic, of the Caribbean, have received a lot more attention recently, but in the late 19th century, that wasn't necessarily the case. And it's quite interesting that Hugo Schuchart himself, as he was developing this interest, devoted a lot of his production to the Asian Portuguese Creoles, which is fortunate because some of the varieties, the Creole language varieties that he was documenting and talking about and writing about, have now disappeared. So for some of them, his work is the only source of information that we have. Now, interestingly, in his private archive, in addition to what he published about these languages, there's additional information, so it's worth going through that. Because the interesting thing is that Hugo Schuchart, like so many others of his time, the way he collected data, linguistic data from across the world, was by sending letters and asking correspondents who lived across the world to send back information. And many of these letters are now preserved in the University of Graz in Austria, which is where he worked most of his life, and they're available. In fact, there is a big project going on to digitize, contextualize, and make available all of this archive. I have collaborated with a few of the letters, the ones that interest me, the ones I will be showing you, and this is where I discovered some interesting things I didn't know and I want to share with you. Now, before we do that, on this slide you have Hugo Schuchart himself and also a list of the publications in his life that he actually put out about the Asian Portuguese Creoles. And you can see that there is one about Cochin, there is one about Diu, the Creole of Diu. There's one about the Creole of Mangalore. So these are all in India. There's one in Mahé and Cananore, about Mahé and Cananore, also in southern India. There's a general one about Indo-Portuguese overall, by which he actually meant Asian Portuguese, right? Because it touches on also the Creoles of Macau, Malacca, etc. There is a big, big study about the Creole of Batavia and Tugu in modern-day Indonesia. This language has now disappeared, but because of him, we have a very large corpus which has been studied. And he also prepared a manuscript about the Creole of Ceylon, modern-day Sri Lanka, which he never published, but it's in the archive and has now been edited as well. So these are the varieties he wrote about. But his epistolary corpus goes far beyond this geography. Among his epistolary corpus, there are 30 correspondents which say something about the Luso-Asian Creoles or the Asian Portuguese Creoles. And it's interesting who these people were. So how did he put together his network of informants? Many of them are priests and missionaries, like these names here, some of which will come up again. So these would be go-to people that he could contact across the world to ask for samples, linguistic samples, sociolinguistic information about the communities that they were familiar with. Priests and missionaries, also colonial administrators, many of them. A few philologists and linguists of his time, and then other people who don't fit in this category, including, for example, speakers of the language who were willing to provide information. These are the locations which are mentioned in the corpus of these 30 correspondents about the Luso-Asian Creoles, all of these. Now, the color scheme here is as follows. The locations in blue are the ones for which Shuhart himself published the data. So that list of articles that I just showed you, so Diu, Mangalore, Cananore, Mahé, etc. So all of the information he collected in these letters about the locations in blue, we already knew about them from his publications. And then the locations in green are locations which are mentioned here, so there is data in the corpus, but in addition to that, there are publications by other people about those Creoles. Okay, so we already also knew something about these languages. The ones in red are the ones which are completely new in the corpus. So there's information that's provided about these locations, which is sometimes even very surprising for us. So these are what I call the lost Luso-Asian Creoles. And these are the ones I will be focusing on. The region of the Coromandel in southeastern India, the area of Bengal, what is now Myanmar, Burma, and also the island of Flores. So, for the Coromandel coast, these are the locations, again, which are mentioned in the corpus, so we have some information about all of this. Now, the kind of data that we gather from these letters is very varied. Okay. In some cases, all that you have is a brief mention of the language being spoken there, some form of Portuguese being spoken there, and sometimes the only information you get is that there used to be speakers in this location, but not anymore. Okay. But in a few cases, we actually get linguistic information. So I will not be talking about all of these. I will not even be talking about all of the people who write about these locations because there isn't enough time. I will focus on the ones which are more meaningful for us and richer in terms of data. These are the sources for the Coromandel. There are letters by Julien Vincent, which is a very famous, important French linguist and Indologist, who had the advantage of having been raised in Pondicherry. You can see Pondicherry here, right, which was at the time a French colony. He was raised there, which means that he knew the linguistic situation there relatively well, even though he was only there in the for his childhood. But he could comment with some propriety on Pondicherry. There is Louis Saint-Cyr, who was a French missionary of the Madurai mission, covering the southern part of this area here. And there is Antonio Tomás da Silva, Leitão e Castro, who was at the time the bishop prelate of Mozambique, but he had earlier been the resident of Mylapore, so he comments on this area as well. Mylapore, right here, to the south of the city of Madras, modern-day Chennai. Robert Caldwell, an Anglican missionary who was Bishop of Tironelveli and a linguist, who is going to be very famous and very well known to anyone who works with Tamil, because he's the one credited with discovering and defining the Dravidian language family, even though that's a little Eurocentric, but anyways. And then there's William Miller, a Scottish missionary who was operating in the Madras mission. So I will not show you the data for all of these because, as I say, sometimes they're not too relevant, but there are a few informations which are quite precious to us. And I start with Caldwell, who was particularly familiar with the southern part of the Coromandel coast. And what he says at some point in his letter is that if I had been at all in India, I should have been happy to endeavor to obtain for you the information you desire respecting the local varieties of the Indo-Portuguese language spoken on the Coromandel coast. There is a considerable number of Indo-Portuguese Christians in all the large towns of the coast, including especially São Tomé, a suburb of Madras. Most of these persons have ceased to speak Portuguese, but in the recently published reprint of the Indian Census of 1881, I find that 3,641 persons are entered as speaking Portuguese in the Madras Presidency. So, as you see, this is a very brief mention, but it is precious because we know so little about this area and this issue. And it's particularly interesting that he says that most of these persons have now ceased to speak Portuguese. That gives you an idea that up until this point, there would have been a significant community of Portuguese speakers in the area. Vincent is a little more concrete, and here he's talking specifically about Pondicherry and the other French colonies in Asia, in India at the time. Obviously, Schuchart must have asked him if there was any sort of French patois, French Creole spoken there, and he says that there was no such thing. He says there is no Creole patois whatsoever in the French establishments of India. There, people speak either French or Tamil, that is, either French or the local language. No mixed or composite language formed, analogous to a Creole. Just some Indian words enter the language used by the descendants of Europeans and vice versa. But then he actually adds, almost all mulattoes speak an Indo-Portuguese dialect. And this is quite interesting for us because, you know, this particular mention, this is not something I can develop here now because of the time, but this particular reference set me searching for further information about the possibility of Portuguese Creole being spoken in Pondicherry up to the 19th century. And in fact, I've now found a lot of other references, so it's quite well established that there was a section of the colonial population of Pondicherry which was Indo-Portuguese speaking rather than Indo-French speaking. But this is a different matter for another time. Louis Saint-Cyr, writing in 1883 about the Madurai mission, he notices that in the whole area, the Portuguese element is unnoticeable and almost absent. And he offers a reason for that. He says, with the Dutch, since the mid-17th century, having taken control of Nakapatnam, Tuticorin, and other coastal towns, the Portuguese who had settled there left the area in large numbers. And those who stayed mostly ended up being absorbed into the Dutch element and later on into the English element. In Nakapatnam, we still find some 20 families of mixed Portuguese, some with beautiful names such as the Taíde, the Albuquerque, the Barreto, etc., etc. But they are very poor and enjoy no consideration. And then he goes on to say, with respect to the Portuguese language, we can say that it is currently unknown in these parts of Madurai, and it is not taught anywhere. The few families I have mentioned above still speak a kind of Portuguese in their homes. Again, an important reference for us. But English and Tamil, the local language, are used more often there. These observations apply only to our Madurai mission, because we know that in other parts of India, such as Madras, Cochin, Bombay, Calcutta, etc., the Portuguese element has resisted better and is more evident. This is, again, not new, but it kind of strengthens the story for the city of Nagapattinam, because a few years later, there is someone else, a priest, a Goan priest, Dalgado, who actually was able to collect some Creole linguistic samples from Nagapattinam and published an article. So Saint-Cyr was quite right in mentioning that even though there was just a very small number of people speaking Creole there at this time, they still existed. What's particularly interesting is the letter by Leitão e Castro, who had been a missionary there and knew the area relatively well. He says, having traveled the Coromandel coast and having resided for a while in Malapur, I have found nothing written in Creole Portuguese, and I do not think there is anything. in Mylapore and Madras. There are now few people who speak it, but on the contrary, in Kudalur, Pondicherry, Trankobar, and Karikal, that is the language used by the Christian East Indian people, or hatted men, men in hats, something like that. However, it differs so much from our Portuguese that it is impossible to have the slightest idea of what those Indians want to say to us, nor are we able to make them understand our Portuguese. This reference is precious because it gives you, first of all, a list of places where he could still hear a kind of Portuguese being spoken, but also that this kind of Portuguese was so deviant from what he knew that he could hardly understand it, which does reference the fact that they were speaking Creole Portuguese. And then he adds actually some linguistic data, which again is precious. The Portuguese language mixed there with Tamil, French, and English, which is nowadays the official language of the entire coast, with the exception of the small territories of Pondicherry and Karikal, which were French, has become corrupted, it seems to me, with the Portuguese words losing their endings with the speed of pronunciation, following the ways of foreign languages, such as English and Tamil, in the declension of nouns, the conjugation of verbs, and the transposed placement of words, designating some objects by their Tamil name, others by the name they have in Portuguese or English, and admitting from those languages one part of the clause or another. So, the impersonal infinitive of verbs or any other tense of person came to designate all tenses in person. So, this is one layman's way of saying that the verb forms were invariant, which is something that we recognize from Creole languages at large. For example, mim papiar is what they say for I speak. Vos patem bom, for father are you well. Min zatavai, for I am leaving right away. Berig fom comer, for I am hungry, I want to eat. So this probably doesn't look like much, but it's all the information we have, the linguistic information we have, for the kind of Portuguese that was spoken around Madras and Mylapore. Creole Portuguese, therefore, differs from ours, first, in the intonation of the voice, imitated from other languages, second, in the rapid pronunciation of words there, fusing the end of one with the beginning of another in such a way that you cannot understand anything, third, in the adulteration of Portuguese words through the omission of syllables as much at the end as at the beginning. For example, the word estar, which is reduced to ta, again, something that we recognize from the Creoles that are still spoken and that we can access, by suppressing the first syllable and the R of the last one. Fourth, in the meaning of many of those words, such as ter, which in Portuguese means to have, meaning estar, which would be to be. And this is, again, one of the most well-registered and most significant characteristics of the Portuguese-based Creoles of Asia, that they have this conflation between to have and to be. Fifth, in the introduction of foreign words, just as adulterated as ours. Sixth, in not declining nouns nor conjugating verbs, so again, invariant nouns, invariant verbs, not distinguishing the gender and number of adjectives, so no such morphology, with one case of the declension, one tense and one person of the verb, one gender or number of the noun or adjective, for all that they wish to express. In the lack of compliance with our rules of syntax, in such a way that no idea or a general thought presides over either the use or the placement of words to form clauses, or the placement of these to compose speech. Now, obviously, the last part of this comment is pure prejudice, right? But the issue of the lack of compliance with our rules of syntax is important for us. So, even though this is a very brief description with some non-specialist comments on language, we can infer a couple of things about what Coromandel Creole would have been at the time. So, judging from these comments, here's a brief summary. The main characteristics would have been something like this. So, he noticed, apparently, some kind of code switching, which is hardly surprising in a place like India. It happens all the time. He notices, again, also borrowings from English and Tamil, which is also not surprising at all. He perceived differences in intonation and in the rate of speech in relation to Portuguese, obviously, which would have been his comparison referent. But he doesn't go beyond that, so, you know, we have to leave it at that. He notices the reduction or the elision of post-stressed syllables, So any syllable after the stress in the etymon, in the Portuguese etymon, seems to have been reduced. And it gives some examples like pad for padre or berig for barriga. This is quite interesting too, because the Creoles that still exist in India, especially the ones from Diu, Daman, Korlai, so the northern ones, have exactly this characteristic. So we have here another piece of evidence that this would have been a rather typical Creole of the region. Invariant nouns and adjectives, invariant verbs, normally based on the Portuguese infinitive, such as papiar, which, by the way, is another verb that we recognize very well from the Creoles in general. But also tem, not, so these two verbs, tem and vai, to have and to go, seem to have been exceptions, because the forms that he presents are not from the infinitive. And again, this is consistent with what we know, because in many of the Luso-Asian Creoles that we can access now, these verbs are also exceptions. So again, we have some evidence here that what we're talking about is the typical Creole that would circulate in Asia at the time. Personal pronouns, he mentions the form me for the first person singular and vos for the second person singular. There seems to have been a functional conflation of Portuguese possessive verb ter, to have, and the stage level copula estar, which, as I mentioned, is a characteristic of the Creoles of Asia in general. So it's quite nice that he noticed this. Verbal operator ta from Portuguese estar, which we also find in the other Creoles. Peculiar word order in relation to Portuguese. It doesn't say any more than this, unfortunately, but it's interesting that he does. And there seems to have been extreme ellipses. Okay? So this is all what we know about the Coromandel. Moving on to Bengal, and I will breeze through Bengal because there isn't much that we can say. These are the locations mentioned in the letters, okay, clustering mostly around the area of Calcutta, Chinsurabandil, Chandranagore, but then also Chittagong, which is now in Bangladesh. And here, for Bengal, we don't find any linguistic information. We only find sociolinguistic information, again, from the same informant, Antonio Ledoy Castro, and by John Beams, who was a British civil servant who served in India. And what all that we find is that the reference that one or another Christian family in Bandel, in Chinsura, in Calcutta, in Shripur, and Chandranagore in the Bengal presidency spoke Portuguese, showing influence of Bengali and Hindustani. And with respect to what some indigenous Christians speak in Basin and Salcedo of the Bombay Presidency, it is much reduced in relation to that. And then Beams just refers that in Chittagong there was a large colony of Portuguese. They mostly speak a corrupt dialect of Bengali. Only a few can speak English and fewer still Portuguese. So Portuguese seems to have been almost gone at the time there. But it was still around. So that was it for Bengal, not very interesting. Burma is more interesting, even though there is only one letter about it. It's a very rich one. These are the locations mentioned in that letter: Rangoon, Molman, Tavoy, and Mergui. And the source is a French missionary, Paul Ambroise Bigandet, who was vicar apostolic of the southern Burma mission and a scholar of Buddhism, one of the first people to write about Buddhism in French. This letter is quite fascinating. He says, "I regret to inform you that the Portuguese language, that is the patois honored with that title, has completely disappeared from Rangoon, Molman, Tavoy, and Mergui, and to such an extent that I can hardly find a person in these four locations who can converse in Portuguese." But then he also adds that when I arrived in 1837 on the coast of Tenasserim, that's this southern coast here, I had to start learning the Portuguese patois to make myself understood by the Christians. Okay, so there seems to have been a very rapid decline in the use of Portuguese from 1837 to 1882. But I soon realized that this language, understood only by those who speak it, could not be the means to impart religious instruction to the poor. So it was widely used, but only by a particular subset of the population, not by everyone. Within 40-something years, the Portuguese patois completely disappeared. When I arrived in Tavoy in 1837, they used to sing Portuguese hymns during Christmas for Epiphany, but these have also disappeared. Several old men and women that I have inquired from with regard to these hymns told me that they remember hearing it being spoken when they were children. Okay, so this is it for the sociolinguistic information. It's precious because we didn't know this up until this letter came up. But then he, even more interestingly for us, he actually gives some remarks about the language itself. The salient characteristics of the patois I found are, first, near total omission of the article, not surprising if you know anything about Creoles. Often the plural of the noun is unused, again, not surprising, so it seems the nouns, again, were invariant, and there was no morphological way of marking a number. Almost all modifications of nouns and pronouns are neglected. This is the same thing, right? So there's no modification, there's no change in the form. The adjectives that qualify a plural noun have the singular form, no agreement. What designates past and future is expressed by two simple words, ja and lo, added to the present. And this ja and lo is exactly, are exactly the two most typical tense markers that we find in the Luso-Asian Creoles everywhere from Sri Lanka all the way to Macau and Malacca, right? So again, it seems to have been a typical Creole part of this family that we can still access. The final R consonant of the infinitive is always left aside. I regret that it is not in my power to give you more complete information, nor find someone who can do so. For this patois, in addition to no longer being spoken, except in Malacca, was never written nor studied, and was no more than a lingua franca of the ignorant, and especially of the seamen. This is someone who had been in Malacca too, before before he went to this part of modern-day Burma. So obviously he could see the connections, the linguistic connections between the Creole of Malacca, which is still alive, still used, and this. So all of the linguistic remarks he makes are consistent with the idea that what was spoken in the southern Burma coast up until 1860 or 70 was very similar to Malacca Creole. And finally, Flores Island. Flores Island is now part of Indonesia, but it has a strong historical connection with the Portuguese. And there are some remarks in the archive of Schuchart about this, not only about Flores itself, which is this island here, with Larantuka being the main settlement the Portuguese had there, but also some information coming from the island of Savu and some reference to East Timor. The sources for this area, Flores, Timor, you know, these islands around Timor, are the following in the corpus, in the archive. George Karl Niemann, a Dutch naturalist, who doesn't say much anyway, but he comments on the fact that he knew the area and couldn't find a lot of linguistic use of Portuguese there. Timon Henricus de Kinderen, who was the secretary of the Royal Batavian Society of Arts and Sciences. José dos Santos Vaquinhas, a Portuguese military man who was a colonial administrator who served in Timor, but in addition to serving in Timor, he traveled around. So he was in Flores, he was in Batavia. He comments on the use of Portuguese in all of these regions. We'll see in a moment. And Johan Hendrikian, a Dutch philologist, was born in Java. Kian says only the following: considering that it may interest you, I am sending you a so-called Portuguese pantun from the island of Flores, East Larantuka, with a Malay translation of or whatever has been offered by a local as such. Not only in the Malay text, whose weaknesses are easily explained by the fact that Malay is not the language of the locals, but also in Portuguese are some things not clear to me. It seems to fall back on peculiar formations of the local language. In either case, mené is the word for child, which could come from menino in Portuguese. The excerpt was sent to me by a Dutch missionary in Savu. How and from whom he got the pantun, he does not write. So again, this doesn't say much, but the fact that he was able to collect a pantun in a variety of Portuguese from the island of Flores is significant. Unfortunately, the pantun is not part of the letter itself. It must have been a separate document, and it's not there to be found. Or if it is, no one has yet identified this text. So all that we have is this reference. The writings by Vikingas, and I'm about to finish, are a lot more concrete and more interesting for us. He says, I myself heard corrupted Portuguese spoken in Batavia. The people who deny that such a form of Portuguese is spoken in Batavia certainly do not know the Portuguese language, and above all, what corrupted Portuguese is. Otherwise, I cannot explain how some people deny the truth of such a fact. So he was very adamant about what he had found when he was traveling in Batavia. And obviously, some people did not believe that this language still existed. And the same thing goes for the Flores, apparently. I can also assure Your Excellency that in some places of the island of Flores and others close to it, the same corrupted Portuguese is still spoken. This is the most concrete mention of this fact that we have from the late 19th century, which I had a chance of observing over 16 years that I lived in Oceania, where I learned to speak some dialects of those islanders and made many trips around those islands. On a different letter, he writes, I attached some notes on the Creole Portuguese spoken in Dili, East Timor. But then he adds, the corrupted Portuguese spoken in Larantuca Flores is the same which is spoken in Dili. Quite interesting for us. We don't have any linguistic data for the Creole of Flores, but for someone who knew both locations to find that they were basically the same is significant. And in yet another letter, he says, many sons of the kings and rulers of Larantuca were educated in the Portuguese schools of Oikuse, Lifau. This is in Timor, which means that as far as the late 19th century, you would have people coming from Flores to Timor to be educated in the Portuguese schools. And that is why Creole came to be spoken in Larantuca. Currently, some boys from Larantuca are studying with the Portuguese missionaries in the school of Lahana in Dili, so this was going on. They never lose their will to learn Portuguese, which they forget as the years go by. And that is why they come to speak corrupted Portuguese or Creole Portuguese. Now, these are the references. Clearly, what I've brought to you are just scattered references, which for many other linguistic situations would not have been, you know, of great use. But the fact that we know so little about the spread and the use and the chronology of the disappearance of Portuguese from these areas that I've talked about makes these very brief comments incredibly precious to us. And so since there are references like this to be found in Hugo Schuchart's archive, it wouldn't be impossible that there are other references of the kind in other archives still to be found to complete this story. Also, I was focusing on the areas which are least known, but Hugo Schuchart's archive is very rich in actual linguistic data for all of the other locations which I showed you on the map. So it's a very precious source of information for us, and most of it, or a lot of it, is now available online. So if you go to the Hugo Schuchart archive, you will be able to access this information and some context as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Hugo, for this impressive 19th century map of the lost Asian Portuguese Creoles in India and Southeast Asia. And now we move eastward to China. And I would ask to Mario Pinheirananda now Nunes to take his seat. Mario Pinheirananda Nunes is assistant professor at the Department of Portuguese of the University of Macau. And he is one of the co-editors, as I have already said, of the volume Iberia-Asian Creoles with Hugo and other colleagues, and is the author of the monograph Multilingual Idioms, published by the University of Macau in 1999. And his presentation today is titled Macau Portuguese Pidgin Phrasebooks and Creole texts from inter to extra community context. Please.
Yes, thank you. Just sorry, a correction, not your mistakes, mine on my home page, which is very outdated. The idioms book was actually published by University of Malaya when I was still working there. Well, now we're shifting a little further eastward to Macau specifically. And my talk will be basically on comparing sort of the Macau pidgin phrase books with Macau Creole texts from the 19th century. In my talk, I would like to emphasize the contribution that these several corpora may give to the study of the genesis, both of the pidgin and of the Creole text, of the Macau Portuguese Creole, which I will from now on refer to as Maquista. It's also referred to as Patois or Dossi Papiasan de Macau. My emphasis on this is that given the very well documented and known presence of the Portuguese from South Asia to extending to Southeast Asia from the mid-15th century onwards, and the documented existence of Creoles as well as pidginized varieties of those Creoles, many of which Hugo just mentioned, in this area, most probably merchants and traders and sailors coming from South China would have already definitely been in contact with these pidgins and creoles, which became a lingua franca, as you all know better than me, in the Southeast Asian trade route, long before the Portuguese actually reached the south coast of China and established themselves in Macau. I'm emphasizing this now, and then I will come back to this point, because of some studies that have very recently come out on the so-called pidgin, Macau pidgin phrase books. Well, those of you from history will be very familiar with this sort of numbers. Why I've got this here is just to stress the very heterogeneous origins of the settlement of Macau, especially if we look here at the 1560-1564 census. This was taken from Kunin et al., published in 1998 in Macau, and they have emphasized here the very diverse origins of the people, so Indians, African slaves, and again in 1565 there is the very important addition of the presence of Malays and Indians again, and the Chinese. So what I have centered on in my previous research on Maquista specifically was that the possibility that given this very heterogeneous initial settlement of Macau with a very, very reduced number of Portuguese speakers, Portuguese here as not used as it's usually used in terms of Asian Portuguese, but European Portuguese at the time, we could very probably defend that the origins of Maquista would not have been as an initial linguistic contact between southern Chinese speakers, so in this case Cantonese and also Hokkien speakers, with Portuguese, but rather that Maquista would have developed already from an existing continuum of Creoles from Southeast Asia, specifically that of Malacca, so Cristang, and its different varieties, Batavia, even Flores. And now we won't be able to see that, because what I wanted to highlight was just at this right-hand corner, but I would just like, what this traveler from the 19th century here states is that at this period of time, so 1836, there were 5,000, thank you, there were 5,000, the population was around 5,000 in Macau, Portuguese population, including slaves. So it's important to note that even as far as the 19th century, so slaves were still a very important part of the so-called Portuguese community, and these slaves would still be coming obviously from Southeast Asia, South Asia, but also Africa. And I'm emphasizing this again to say that there would definitely have, given the different degrees of proximity imposed by the social and political status of the community, There would have been varying degrees of within this pidgin to Creole continuum. Just to emphasize again the point of the importance of slaves and the servants, I have here two quotes from travelers again, one French, La Volée, where he mentions the boys, so I'm sorry, the translation is not from, is into Portuguese because it was taken from an article by Carneiro de Souza. And it's translated as the boys have normally between 18 and 25 years old, but what I want to really emphasize is what I've put in yellow. So they speak an Anglo-Chinese patois, so this is also referring to the house servants in Hong Kong at the time. So in Hong Kong, he refers that they speak an Anglo-Chinese patois. When he comes to Macau, he says a great number of them also speak Portuguese, which is interesting that he doesn't mention that they speak the patois or a Creole language. But obviously here, I'm sure Portuguese would be considered as, should be read as the Creole or any pigeonized variety thereof. Then again, a very late 19th century, early 20th century record by Ball, an English traveler this time, he states again, he mentions the coolie trade. So coming from the very beginning of the establishment of Macau until right up to the very early 20th century, we have a huge population and flexible population in Macau coming from different areas of Southeast and South Asia, and in this case, the coolie trade, of course, as you all know, mainly from China. These coolies were, as you can see in this image, just because I found it interesting that he mentions here they were lodged in buildings called barracoons, and then in the New York State Library, I found this image of the so-called barracoons where these Chinese coolies would be lodged before their embarkment. And so all this flux of peoples in Macau, no matter for how long they were actually there for, whether they were house servants and lived permanently with the Portuguese and the Macanese families they were working for, whether they were slaves being transported hither and thither, or whether they were coolies waiting to be shipped elsewhere, this would have definitely, for the whole of the, if we come up to the 19th century, the almost 400 years of Portuguese presence in Macau, would have stimulated a setting of a lot of variation, linguistic variation, between the different lects within the Creole, the Pidgin Creole cycle. Adding to this, we have from very early on the description of the division of the Christian and the Chinese city. So one of the very earliest Chinese mentions of this is actually in one of the phrase books that I'm going to be speaking of. It's got the English and Portuguese translation of Brief Monography of Macau, and it was published in 1751. It was commissioned by the Mandarin at the time at Guangdong, who commissioned two of his officers to go to Macau and record what the Portuguese were up to there at the time. And they mentioned these fences, which later on would have become the wall dividing the Christian city and the Chinese city. As far very further ahead, late 19th century, we have Francis still speaking of the division of this city. So this emphasizes yet again the division of the various communities, and which would make it favorable for the existence of pigeons or various types of pigeons. And the Creole, the Maquista, which was basically the language of the endogenous Asian, Luso-Asian community of Macau. Again, I found this also interesting, that even in the historical section of the Foreign Office, the British Foreign Office, as late as 1920, they are speaking of the division of this Christian and Chinese quarter. By the way, these documents were commissioned by the Foreign Office during the First World War to give the British government a extensive knowledge of all the French and Portuguese territories in Asia. And then they were published because there was interest in that. In the same document, we find a very interesting reference, which is on race and language, and I'm going to quote now. The Maquista speak a Portuguese patois, very unlike real Portuguese. There are three forms of this dialogue. They're spoken by the lower class, a form that approximate more to pure Portuguese, and as spoken by the Chinese. I found this very relevant because there are scattered references of different levels of the patois or different approximations to the standard language in several travelers prior to this reference, but that it should exist as late as 1920. I found that extremely interesting and valuable to what I want to say later on. Well, finally, we come to the phrase books. On the right, yes, on the right, on your right, you have the phrase book. Which, of course, this is not the original text. It's a translation and an edition from 1998, if I'm not mistaken. But the phrase book was the monography, which I spoke earlier on, was published in 1751. Most of the text has nothing to do with language. It's got to do with, as I said, the description of Macau at the time, the administration, how the Portuguese administered Macau. It's the view of the Chinese of the Portuguese, as well as of the Africans, for example, that they brought to Macau, and that and with whom the Chinese, or at least were encountering in great numbers at the time. So that description is very interesting as well. But what interests us here today is basically the word list that comes at the end of the monography. That word list is very much similar to another word list, a phrase book, this one specifically a phrase book. The date we are not sure of yet, but as Michelle Lee Stephen Matthews from the University of Hong Kong, who have very recently published two articles, just last year, and also one in 2013, in fact, in the volume Hugo and I edited that was mentioned here. This compendium was found by a Chinese scholar, Zhu, and who also has an article on this from 2011, if I'm not mistaken. And it seems to be the manuscript, or sorry, the phrase book that Samuel Wells Williams speaks of in 1836 or 37 as well. He describes the existence of two phrase books, one in English for Chinese and the other one in Portuguese Chinese, and the description is very similar. What I want to stress here is that given the background that I gave you very briefly and not very completely, sorry, because of a question of time, but the linguistic and sociolinguistic background of Macau until the time, whereas Matthews and Lee stress that this pidgin would have come from, or would have been based, as they say, on the Maquista Creole, so on the Macau Creole, given the background that I mentioned, I think that some characteristics of that we can see in the phrase books have to be looked at in the light of this very fluid linguistic situations, because some characteristics could actually be still from a pidgin which apparently must have existed, or various varieties of those pidgins, sorry, from the 16th century onwards. One of the situations, I can't go into detailed linguistic analysis here, but one of the questions we can pick on is, for example, the TMA markers. We know that universally, Creoles tend not to mark, pidgins tend not to mark, pidgin languages tend not to mark aspect. and definitely not tense. Yet this pidgin phrase book does include two aspect markers, the ja and the logu. Logu was already touched on by Hugo, actually, which sometimes is reduced to lo or lu. So, yes, this could be an indication that this probably pidgin phrase book would have been influenced or based on the Macau pidgin. However, we should also look at the fact that these two markers already existed in Cristang and all the creoles prior to the formation of Macau. Another interesting issue is the absence of the marker ta, the progressive marker ta. Now, we know also from, especially looking at the work in Apex of the comparison of the world worldwide comparison of pidgin and creole and the atlas, that ta is almost absent in all pidgins, and it's a marker which is absent there, and it is also absent in this phrase book in any case. Sorry. But the absence, we should not, in my view, look at it as a result of a pidgin that has just been formed in the 19th century, when the trade between European forces and China increased, and so there was this was the setting for the Chinese pidgin English, and simultaneously, the suggestion in Lee and Matthews is that the same setting would have then developed the Portuguese pidgin creole. We could look at it also as a characteristic of a pidgin that might have existed previously, and therefore the continuation of the existence of this marker. We should also note here that the Cantonese language, contrary to Mandarin and other Chinese languages, as well as other substrate languages of Makishta from South Asia, the aspect marking is very flexible. In other words, the marking is not obligatory. So the fact that this is very flexible could make it less frequent, and therefore the continuous in existence of this marking. Another aspect I would like to touch on here is the personal pronoun and possessive adjective minha, which and this glossing I took directly from Lee and Matthews. So we have here the transliteration into pinyin according to the Cantonese pinyin developed by the in Hong Kong Linguistic Society. And at the bottom, well, here we have the linguistic glossing, and then that would be the creole or pidgin correspondence, so San Minha Casa. It's interesting that whereas it is true that pidgins do use a personal pronoun, indirect object, as a personal pronoun. So, for example, in Portuguese, so that would, instead of saying eu, many pidgins would say ming, as in English they also have me. But this phrase book uses minha, which is the possessive pronoun. Now, the interesting thing is that when we look at the 19th century texts of Creole, and when we look at data from Arana Ward, which is a master's thesis done in Hong Kong in the 1970s, working with elderly speakers, so the very elderly speakers, and which would have been already the last generation of L1 Makishta speakers, Creole speakers, they very, very, very seldomly use the possessive marker minha, the possessive adjective minha. What they do use is this form, which is similar to the Cristang creole, eu sa casa. So they wouldn't even say minha as the personal pronoun, and they wouldn't say minha as the possessive adjective. So my question to how this comes to be in a pidgin phrase book, and to consider this a development of the pidgin, it could in fact revert us to some earlier existent pidgin, where prior to the establishment of the creole, so to say, Or, on the other hand, we could interpret it in the same sense as Lee and Matthews have done, and which I think is very valid, that the informants for the construction of these phrase books could have been of various degrees of proximity to the standard language. So we could have somebody informing the author of the phrase book who would have a very very near standard proficiency of Portuguese, because to have it as a development from directly from the Creole, well, then the problem is the Creole texts, at least the second part of the Creole text, that is to say the plays and the anecdotes, basically do not have this possessive form. The letters, I'm still going to, if I have time, I have no idea how long I've spoken for. If when we look at the 19th century texts, we can divide them into two parts, as I will in a few slides tell you. Letters between an aunt and a niece, and short theatrical texts and anecdotes. And they too must have obviously been written by either two different people or more than two different people, but the letters definitely written by the same person who has a nearer proficiency or is at an let's say an acrolect level of the Creole stage, because Minha does appear in those letters, but then it does not appear almost or almost totally absent in the other texts. Finally, one last linguistic aspect here of the phrase books is regarding topicalization, and I'm citing from Lee now, quoting from Lee, where she explains that topicalization is a syntactic strategy that moves a constituent to the front of the sentence for discourse purposes. And this is very common in Sinitic languages. But as Lee says, topicalization is not attested for in the pidgin, Portuguese pidgin, Macau Portuguese pidgin phrase books. However, I disagree with them here, because I do find at least two instances, I myself have not yet studied the whole phrase book. I am at the moment doing this in conjunction with a research student of mine. I do not read Chinese, unfortunately, so she's doing the transliteration of it for me. And we have so far found these two instances. Of course, they are lacking the base sentence. We have only this very short excerpt. However, if we consider that this was in a context to speaking of trade, good, merchandise, wherever, it definitely does look as like a question of topicalization. We have nunca chega preço instead of preço nunca chega, and tudo tem instead of tem tudo. But again, it's just a suggestion of interpretation, and this would be obviously in favor of the reading of these texts as in fact of a pidgin phrase, of a phase of the language, because, for example, in the other compendium, the compendium of 1751, which is much less limited than this one, it's basically just a word list, as Lee herself says, we don't really know whether this was based on a pidgin phase of or a Creole language, a full Creole language, because we just have single words. And this earlier Chinese, this later Chinese phrase book gives us a slightly more clearer glimpse of that. Okay, thank you. In going back to the title of my talk and looking at these different corpora and the purpose they might have, definitely the Chinese phrase books do have a role of inter-ethnic communicative role here, because they are definitely establishing a written base to communicate between two different communities. This that you see here is the list of topics in the phrase book. The phrase book is incomplete. So far, only one part of the phrase book has been found. It is in the Staatsbibliothek in Berlin, and it's actually accessible online, a PDF version of that. These are the other chapters that exist in the index but are not have not been found, but if you look at the topics, they're very, very much obviously for a direct inter-ethnic communicative role for merchant purposes. I'm going to skip that where I have hardly any time to speak of the 19th century texts, unfortunately, but they were published initially in this four volumes, Tasi Yang Kwa, which basically means the Eastern Kingdom, the Royal Kingdom, the Celestial Kingdom of the Eastern Seas. They were collected by João Feliciano Marques Pereira. He was a distinguished Macanese person at the time in politics and in arts as well. And the whole collection actually is very much in line with the 19th century European vision of the Orient and the exotic view that Europe was so much in search of the Orient. But within all the descriptions, social, historic, philosophical texts that we find there, we then also find these texts written in Makishta. The authors are unknown, many times, a little bit in the line of Shuhart. Also, he would receive questions or he would make questions on specific linguistic data and people would then answer him to his questions. The texts basically cover these genres: letters, morality plays, songs and anecdotes. And I'm coming, this is my second last slide. Basically, the texts cover a satirical and critical view. So again, inner and outer groups. I say inner and outer groups because initially I used to look at these texts as written by the Makishtas, so almost as a look towards their own community, because if I may say in one sentence, this period for the Macanese and the speakers of Makishta is a very critical period of time and where they question their identity and the continuation of that identity, because the British are now in Hong Kong, they've established themselves in Hong Kong, many Macanese shifted over to Hong Kong, the younger generation stopped speaking, so there is a generational gap in the transmission of the mother language, so the Creole language, and most of these texts are appealing to the preservation of their identity, the preservation of the Makishta identity. However, if we think that they must have obviously been written by well-educated Macanese or even Portuguese who lived there for a long time, we then and looking at them included in this European 19th century love of the exotic Orient, they sort of also seem to be a look by a European look on that community and portraying them as something exotic. So just to final considerations, I see that the phrase books have a practical purpose to communicate with the others, but nowadays they have the purpose of giving us insights into the Chinese, Portuguese, Macanese 19th century context, as well as insights into linguistic features. But these insights will always be still almost just guesses, as I tried to show by the three slides I touched on. The 19th century texts, on the other hand, have a general purpose, and I have A and B here with question marks, because I don't know which would be the main purpose of the texts, either to show the unknown and the exotic of the European Portuguese, or as a safeguard Macanese customs and language among the communities. However, what I want to stress in both these sets of corpora is that they definitely give us a view of the fluid and the continuous exchange between different lects and different varieties or pigeonized varieties of Makishta and the presence of other Portuguese-based Creoles of Asia in Macau. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Maya, for keeping also perfectly the time, okay, and also for this very inspiring presentation. I'm sure there will be many questions for it. And now we remain in Macau, but we move backward to the, I guess, previous centuries with the presentation by Paolo De Troia, who teaches at the University of Rome La Sapienza. He's the author of many publications on Chinese language in different contexts, and he's also translator of some of Giulio Aleni's works, and very important missionary in China, and also the editor of the proceedings of the conference La Cina il Mondo, China and the World, published by Nuova Cultura in 2010. And his paper today is titled The College of St. Paul in Macau and the Portuguese, St. Paul's College in Macau, a cross-cultural link between Europe and Asia. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Professor Marcocci, for your introduction. Good morning to everybody. Dear colleagues and dear students, I see a few students here. I'm happy to see a few students. And first of all, let me express my gratitude to the organization of the conference, to Cristina, Angelo, and all the organizing staff of this meeting. It's a pleasure to be with all of you for the second time and to have a chance to discuss our project, which is very important, in my opinion. It is interesting to be here today and with scholars coming from Portugal, from many places. Someone is giving the paper in English, someone will talk Portuguese, and this recalls me the situation, maybe, of the missionaries that we study. They were in Macau, and they were using, maybe in a massive manner, the Portuguese as a lingua franca, so we can feel their feelings. So my paper, it's a general description of facts that are quite familiar to sinologists and also historians of mission and historians of Portugal, but still largely unknown, or maybe little used by the historians of language. And also it's a description of some possibilities for future research and maybe some discovery. The paper focuses mainly on two aspects: the history of St. Paul's College, with particular attention of the role of Portuguese missionaries according to existing Western and Chinese materials, general description of the curriculum, and finally about the problem of archival sources related to the college history and proposal of further research. We know that the sources about St. Paul's College are very quite complicated puzzle for historians. The main need that urged me to think about this topic is with reference to the idea of the space of Portuguese language, is to stress in some way, together with you, the complexity of the cultural framework, of the cultural and historical framework of this project in relation to East Asian missionary history. The need to take into our account the multiple layers of this linguistic space. And I quote Angelo, recently we all received this introduction of the abstract of the project that we are trying to present. And he says that the Portuguese became a lingua franca used by multilingual European and non-European merchant communities, travelers, missionaries from Brazil to African and Asian coast territories. The impact of this phenomena is evidenced by the production of hundreds of reports and descriptions, including word lists, dictionaries, grammars, mostly compiled by missionaries, in particular Jesuits. In spite of the relevance and the pioneering works by a few linguists, these sources are still scattered and understudied, and I totally agree with this vision. So, we start from the beginning. In the second half of the 15th century, we know the Portuguese ships reached the shore of Africa, captured Ceuta, setting in motion a process that later we all know has been named the Age of Discovery. In the following years, Diego Cao reached Congo, Bartolomeo Dias rounded the Cape of Good Hope, and Vasco da Gama cast anchor at Calcutta in 1499. So the route of Indies had been found. And with the capture of Goa in 1511, the foundation of the Portuguese Empire in the East had been finally laid. In the second half of the 16th century, thanks to the privileges given by the Padroado, the Catholic missionaries, chiefly Jesuits, set feet in the so-called East India and began their activities. This history, the life and work of Jesuits in China, has been defined by many historians, I like to recall Joseph Needham, an enterprise without parallel in the history of contact between civilization. Following the historical periodization of the mission by Standart, we can say that from more or less 58 till more or less 18th, the missionary presence in China covers three main periods. The first 50 years was one of the Jesuit presence under the Padroado. With the breve ex pastorale officio, 28th of January 1585, Pope Gregory XIII had given to the Society of Jesus the exclusive right to spread the gospel in Japan and China. So, we have the first Portuguese Jesuits landed in Macau on the 20 November 1555. They were five in number, the vice-provincial, Belchior Nunes Barreto, two other priests, Gaspar Vilela and Antonio Diaz, three scholastics, Mendes Pinto, Belchior Diaz, and Estevao de Goiz. Just a year later, they moved to Japan, but de Goiz remained in Canton to study Chinese, and thus becoming the pioneer student of the language among the Westerners who came to the Far East in the 16th century. And this is curious because we all quote Matteo Ricci and Michele Ruggeri as for talking about the Chinese language and the Jesuit. But in fact, the first Jesuit that was studying Chinese was a Portuguese one, and this is Estevao de Goiz. In a letter from Malacca written by another Portuguese father, Luis Frois, the 19th of November 1556, a letter reported in another letter by Goa, we can read that anno sequenti, sinis in Japoniam trajecturus, Father Melchior Nunes Barreto, Father Antonium Diaz, egrotum Malacca misit, ut salute recuperaret. They got sick and then they went to Malacca to get a rest. But in the meanwhile, Father Stephanum de Goiz in urbe canton linguam sinicam addiscere iussit. So this is very significant in my eyes. So the Jesuit method of apostolate was innovative and unique, we all know. One of the first rules of the order required its members to learn the language of the country in which they resided. In 1557, the Chinese authorized the Portuguese to settle in Macau, and during the first decade after the Chinese allowed Portuguese to live there, Franciscans, Dominicans, Augustinians, and of course Jesuits established houses in the Macau colony. All Jesuits on the way to and from Japan would stop there, such as Ludovicus Frois, the author of the letter that I quoted before. In 1563, Fathers Francisco Perez, Manuel Teixeira, and the novice André Pinto also reached Macau. They received order from the provincial to set a permanent residence for the society. So in this period, we have other written evidences from letters of that period describing the place. We know that there were already a church and a house, some Christians, some Portuguese inhabitants. We found names of many other Portuguese Jesuits living and operating in Macau, such as Fathers Bonaventura Rieira, Gonzalo da Cunha, Baltasar Lopez, João da Mesquita, Francisco Cabral. In a report sent to the Father General, we apprehend that in 1576, there were 14 Jesuits beside the regular staff studying theology, Latin, and other topics. We know that the teaching of theology was always present and more continuous than that of philosophy, at least at the beginning of the college activity. We have other evidences, other written evidences about the presence of fathers carrying out the work of the Macau mission. In 1584, there were 200 students who, besides learning to read and write Portuguese, were taught mathematics, Latin, and music. So Jesuits there, they were teaching Portuguese, learning Portuguese, Jesuits of other nationalities, and maybe teaching Portuguese to the local inhabitants. So it's another test data about the lingua franca, the Portuguese lingua franca, in this important cultural cross. This is another evidence from a letter, a document kept in Biblioteca Nazionale di Roma, Fondo Gesuitico. We apprehend other news about Jesuit, and we can read here, Ete mai uma escola de ler e escrever, aonde andau todos os meninos da cidade. So we have teaching activities already at the second half of 16th century in Macau. The 58 is the turning point for the history of this college, because we know that the father, Alessandro Valignano, arrived in Macau. He saw the need for a systematic training ground for future missionaries in a secure environment. He wrote to the superiors in Rome, explaining that Macau had become the greatest city after Goa in the Portuguese provinces. He stressed the need for raising the residents at Macau to the position of a university, supplied with all classes, equipment, personnel, and premises, to enable it to take its place at the head of the missionary efforts. Valignano's proposal, although the strong opposition of the Jesuits in Goa, received Rome's approval. Valignano was in Macau in 1592. He stayed until November 2 years later. And it was at that time that he supervised the construction of the St. Paul's University, St. Paul's College. So we arrive at 1596, that already we have evidences about the existence of two Jesuit communities in Macau. The one of the residents of the Church of the Mother of God, with 12 members, and the University of St. Paul, with 30 members. In 1762, St. Paul's College came to the end with the expulsion of the Jesuits from Macau. In 1835, the actual buildings themselves were destroyed by fire. But opposite the Church of the Mother of God, there were the office of the treasurer of the province, and also there were the Jesuit archives, where many documents were kept. Later on, before the suppression of the order, copies of the documents were sent to Manila, and then to Portugal and Spain. And we will talk some more about this point later in my paper. But let's go back to the college. The college's main task at the beginning was to educate the Jesuits that they were planning to go to Japan. And we must bear in mind this point, because we talk about St. Paul's and Macau also thinking about the missionary work towards China, but the goal was Japan. And China was not the main target, at least at the beginning. Macau was instrumental to the main goal of the mission, that was the evangelization of Japan. The society's establishment in Macau had been conceived as the hierarchical and logistic center of Japan's missionary province, while China's few missions were not considered a separate province, but mere local communities, depending on that of Japan, until 1623 at least, when they became a division, a vice province of it. Soon, because of Japan's changed attitude toward Christianity, and also because of Matteo Ricci's progress in Beijing, the society began to pay more attention to China and to send scientifically qualified missionaries there to China. At this time, we found classes of Latin in Macau, theology, but also classes specialized in the manners and customs, including clothing of the Japanese, were being conducted. So Japan and Japanese language is a very important topic, in my opinion, in the history of this of this place. And in the sources, we have plenty of evidences about possible contacts, linguistic contact with Portuguese. For instance, catalogs of the Jesuits in Japan, in Japanese mission, listed many Jesuits, most of them Portuguese at the beginning, using Japanese for liturgy, for confessions. For instance, we have this catalog, which is reported by Schutte in Monumenta Japonica, and in the list, he, for many Portuguese missionaries, he said always confessor in lingua japonica, in japonica lingua confessiones auditi. Father Guillermus Pereira, in japonica lingua concionatur et catechizat, concionatur, he gave sermon in Japanese. So they were strong in Japanese, but as Angelo has told at the beginning of this session, nobody tell how they know Japanese so well. Okay, we can take into our account the apologetic tone of this kind of documents. Maybe they were not so proficient in Japanese, but at least we have to indagate. Later on, the focus of the college slowly shifted from Japan to China. And thanks to the encounter, as I already said, with Matteo Ricci, Valignano learned that the language and customs of the Chinese were quite different from those of the Japanese. He realized that in the future, a Jesuit might no longer be moving from one mission in Asia to another, since the complexity, the diversity of the Asian countries. As a result, it was imperative that a Jesuit be prepared for the particular mission even before he set feet on its territory. 3 decades after Valignano's death in 1606, Japan was already inaccessible to all Western missionaries and to all Western merchants except the Dutch. Although these events affected the original purpose of the College of Macau, this educational institution remained a vital link for the missions in China and Southeast Asia, and thereby contributed to the development of the Portuguese missions, of the Portuguese presence in Asia. And it is indeed a valuable tool of study, a useful lens of analysis of the cultural framework in which Portuguese civilization, Portuguese language, let's say the Portuguese world, had contacts with East Asian cultures. The college was crucial for the preparation of missionaries going to China, Japan, Indochina. It was crucial for the exchange of ideas. It has been defined as an essential crossroad for people, object, information. Michele Ruggeri, for instance, the author of the well-known Chinese-Portuguese dictionary, which is also an item included in our project, learned Chinese language here in the college at the beginning. We have here the document that tells us this account, and it's quite interesting. It's a letter from Macau, October 1581, by Father Gomez to Everardo Mercuriani, the general of the Jesuits. And he said that Michele Ruggeri already studied a few thousand Chinese characters, and he has a separate place in the college with all Chinese students studying with him, and he has many contacts with Chinese officials because he knows very well the Chinese language and so on. So Jesuits that should complete their studies met in Macau, met older and experienced missionaries, giving courses and receiving language training. And the history of the college has been largely ignored in some way, especially from the point of view of our project. And from the point of view of language, for instance, we have a few articles by Chinese scholars too. There is an article about the language teaching, the Chinese language teaching in St. Paul's College in Macau by Li Xianyu, 2011, for instance, but it tells no more than something that I already told you before. So, let's talk about some aspects to be considered and discussed. First, the role of the college in teaching Portuguese or learning Chinese through Portuguese. More in general, the teaching of languages and culture, Latin, theology, philosophy, let's say the role of the college in studying and transmitting Western culture in Asia and Asian culture in Europe. The nature of St. Paul's College as the first Western university in Asia, partially responsible of the European mindset concerning China. Further question, for example, what were the sources? What was the content of the courses in cultural studies, in science, in philosophy, in theology? What were the volumes in the library of 4,200 books? Who were the professors and students, the administrator staff? Who were the retired missionaries spending their last years in Macau? How did the seminaries train their students? So, we have a potential gold mine for data, for news about language and cultural contacts, history of teaching, cultural intercourse. But unfortunately, as every historian knows, we must face the problem that most of the documentation about these activities and all other documents about the college have been dispersed. The main reason for this is the Pombal's destruction of the Society of Jesus in the Kingdom of Portugal and its overseas territories. The Portuguese state, which took possession of the archives, scientific instruments, and books, transferred some to Europe and left others in the colonies. But in both cases, disorder and dispersion were frequent for a couple of centuries. And this explains maybe why very little remains in Goa and practically nothing in Macau. In 1773, the papal suppression of the order gave the last stroke to this corpus of sources. A good piece of scientific work that led the way to maybe find some answers to these and other questions is the work by an historian, well-known historian by all of you, Professor Ugo Baldini, to whom I am deep in debt for the content of the following point of my communication. Professor Baldini written an article a few years ago, which is entitled The Jesuit College in Macau as a Meeting Point of European, Chinese and Japanese Mathematical Traditions, published in the volume that you can see. And he focused his attention especially on the teaching of mathematics because he's an historian of science. One important distinction that we must consider among sources is that one between the documentation in the Asian establishment and the writings sent to Europe from them. In fact, the dispersion could affect more the former. As for the latter, a further distinction should be made between documents first addressed to a Jesuit institution or to a member of the Jesuit institution, and those addressed to other person. Anyway, no manuscripts, copies of lessons, dissertation, talks, theses, manuscript works of missionary of college have survived until now, according to our knowledge. But we have different situation as for, first, for letters, and secondly, for the administrative materials, the files of the college archive. A small part of the provincial archives contains copies about Macau College and partially survives through copies in Portugal, Spain, and Rome. Other surviving material are files of the Japan Province and China Province archives. So we can have lists of the person present in Macau in a particular year. We can state their educational role, the superior judgments of each individual, letter by and to the supervisors, reports on special topics, and more interesting, chronicles of the inner life of the Jesuit House of College, as well as external events. As far as the Japanese province is concerned, we can find documents of this kind, of course, in the collection Jesuitas Nasia in Ajuda, in the collection Jesuitas Tomos in the Academia della Historia in Madrid, in the Archive of Rome and other places. In addition to those in the Biblioteca d'Ajuda in Lisbon and in Madrid, the Jesuit General Archive and Biblioteca Vaticana in Rome, and what remains, the very little that remains in Goa, We would take into our consideration also the Fundo General manuscript in the Biblioteca Nazionale in Lisbon, the Munsun code and other section in the Lisbon Torre do Tombo National Archive, the Fondo Gesuitico manuscript of the Biblioteca Nazionale in Rome, those of the archives of the Pontificia Università Gregoriana, of the Congregation de Propaganda Fide, and also a number of French small libraries and archives should be also added to this list. Most of the documents of these places, especially Ajuda, Madrid and Rome, have been carefully scrutinized, but few made research taking into consideration the language issue. For example, language teaching, production of language-related material, nor the idea of Portuguese cultural and linguistic contacts with Asian languages has been fully scrutinized. Starting from the bottom, an unified inventory of materials concerning the College of St. Paul, which is still lacking, those teaching in it and their activities could shed light on a number of obscure points. The great collection in these libraries that I've mentioned so far, as well as others, have been examined by all of us for decades. But the fact that they have been searched mainly by people who were not looking for contacts with the Portuguese lands means that something valuable may still remain to be discovered. I have a very small example. It's not strictly related with Portuguese language, but it's a letter about language, about contact, language contact, that I have found in the archive of Jesuits in Rome, an archive that I had scanned for more than 10 years already. But going again and looking for something related with language, I have found this letter. And this letter was written, it's a long history, but anyway, was written by a Portuguese missionary, André Palmeiro, in 1632, and the letter was sent from Macau, so maybe when he was in the college, and it's a letter that contains a short description of the Chinese language, and a list of words, general words of Chinese language, and then the list in Chinese of the translation in Chinese of the Pater Noster. But the interesting thing is that we have the Latin, the Japanese pronunciation, the Chinese character, the Chinese transcription according to the knowledge of the father, and the Vietnamese pronunciation here. So this is a valuable document for linguists. Looking, for instance, for ingrandire, come si fa? Non lo so. Così. It's a valuable document for linguists looking for information about romanization history, for instance, or and also it's interesting to think about this missionary. He was mainly oriented to the Japanese province for evangelization, but. I would stress the importance of the network structure, how this information arrived to this missionary, because this is quite more or less the same system of transcription of Matteo Ricci that was in Zhaoqing, in another place. So I think it would be important to reconstruct the network of communication and the way of communication. We know that the letters into China, outside China, were moving very fast, but nobody said how. We know the Portuguese route, the Dutch route on the sea, but inside China, inside the colonies, we have very few news. So this is an example of interesting material that we can find scanning with a different lens, scanning with different lens, no archives. And I'm going to conclude. For private letters and reports, the most promising sources, we must follow a less direct way, no in the main archives. Following the methodology of analysis that was proposed by Baldini, a scholar looking for documents about the study of language in the college should start, first of all, making a list of all Jesuits in the college that dealt with language issues or that had been reported to have a special sensibility to language studies. Then, presuming that their friends had intellectual links, were mainly in their countries and town of origin of education, and letters found so far confirm this, the second option may be to scan local archives in the countries, cities and church in the area of origin of the documents, of the people from the social web of the missionaries. There are many possible locations of archival documents, and there is a scope for well-focused research. As pointed out above, both the document produced directly by the institution, catalogs, reports, teaching program, theses, copies for lessons, and their archives were largely lost. So their role as a cultural junctions must be reconstructed mostly through the private testimonies of those who worked within them or saw them working. Most of them, however, were still Jesuits. So their testimonies must be sought at the connection of the network's strands or at their final points. Therefore, a knowledge of the network structure, particularly in its peripheral parts, that is a map of the repositories to which Jesuit documents of a certain area have flowed during time, will soon become a necessary preliminary stage for any oriented research. Concluding, St. Paul's College in Macau, it is a crucial element in the history of the Portuguese language space. Its history, it was an educational institution in late 16th century, considered to be the first European university in China, started by Portuguese, where Portuguese language was spoken and taught, and used for an editorial production. It has been the place for encounter of cultures and languages for almost 200 years, acting as a cradle for missionaries traveling in all East Asia. Its history, as far as the topic of this project is concerned, has been largely neglected. And the problem of the sources presents, in my opinion, fascinating challenges and opens up to the historians new worlds for exploration. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor De Troia, for this very rich presentation, which made us almost physically enter the college in Macau and have presented very important problems related to the archival issues connected to this important institution in East Asia. We have now around 25 minutes, so a very good time to discuss these three presentations that are very coherent. It's a very coherent set of presentation, and so I leave the floor to possible questions, remarks from you, first of all, if any. Please, Cristina.
Available with the material you...
Yes. So this particular archive of Schuchart is now in the process of being edited. And the intention of the editors, who are, Professor Bernard Hursch in Graz and a team, the intention of the editors is that eventually the whole collection, which is huge, by the way, will be available online. Because, but it's very complex, because Schuchart was one of those, I guess, one of those Renaissance men, late Renaissance men. He wrote about not just the Creoles, but he wrote about Basque, and he corresponded with people in Hungarian and German and French and Portuguese and Spanish and Italian. So it's an enormous... Yeah, so editing this has been a challenge. So what the editors are doing is that they select people who have particular interests in particular sections of the archive, which is what happened with me. So I was put in charge of a number of letters that referred to the Asian Creoles, and those people will, as they have time, do the transcription and editing, and then everything is going to be put online. If you go to the website now, you will already find a lot of the archive there. And then the other good thing is that not only do you find the actual scan of the documents and the transcription, you also always find the context, right? So there's an introductory text telling you something about the correspondent and the contents of the letters. So it's quite a rich source. I think you should you should all take a look, because you might find something interesting there. But there's still a lot to be done. In either case, there is a catalog of the archive, and if you find something that's not available online yet but interests you, you can contact the team in Graz, and they will surely send you a scan. They're very approachable.
If I may add one question to Paolo, to the pioneerism, let's say, you call that, well, the first one to describe, or the Chinese language was a Portuguese Jesuit, and we do not talk about that. So my question to you is, what's the point of to be the first one in linguistic historiography or in a linguistic tradition? Is it really important, let's say?
Not in a matter of competition, of course. But it's important because sometimes if you go back in the description, you can find something, you can find a kind of line in this description, and you can try to establish when this line has started. This is a tentative, of course. In terms maybe of historical linguistics. In terms of history, I personally assume that to say that the first Westerner studying, not describing, studying the Chinese language was a Portuguese Jesuit has a certain importance in my eyes, because for us that we are involved in the study of the Jesuit mission in China, is not so common. This vision is not so implicit, and in some way change in some way the weight of the contribution of Italian missionaries. That's my view.
I agree with you, and I also every time I talked about that in the I thought that even if it's not important in himself, or as linguistic historiographers, we have the obligation to bring the past to the present and to inform about it. The new generations will decide how important this must be for the future, as you yeah. point us for the future too.
Yeah, exactly.
And I think, of course, linguistic historiography is not to tell everybody who made the first, etc. This is a chronicle, okay. But the importance is, one of our tasks is to make this forgotten past still alive. That's how I see Angelo's ideas about this project. Okay, I will ask Mario after. Otherwise, I will monopolize a little bit the discussion. Thank you.
If I can add, take advantage of my position, and I can add a little remark to this final discussion. I think that is also very important. I'm not interested in the first in itself, but I think it's important to have this periodization in order to understand the exact context in which some linguistic interest arise in a place or another. So this is very important. The historical perspective here is particularly interesting to understand why exactly in that context, in that moment, they felt necessary to start learning Chinese in this case, which is not so obvious in missionary history, the first moment. It's something which is complex from many points of view. So I think this is very important also, just to add a remark. Other? Yeah, of course. Further questions? Oh, sorry.
I have a little question for Professor, for Mario.
Yes, please.
If
first from the audience and then
if we... Okay.
Sorry.
First, as we know in Brazil, it was Anchieta, he was not Portuguese and he was the first. It's also very important to know why didn't the Portuguese continue after the first. So I have the impression from the letter from Bameiro that later Alexandre de Rhodes, who based himself on Amaral and Barbosa, had a very much more refined transcription system, and the same applies for Chinese. The Trigol system was later very popular for Varro and other sources, but it were not Portuguese who continued. So it's not a question of competition, of course, but it's interesting to know why didn't they get the opportunity, or maybe didn't like to send those manuscripts to printing houses in Portugal or maybe in Asia. It's a very big question, I think, why the Portuguese gradually disappears, and Trigo, he was from French, and Alexander de Rhodes. I'm sorry for this very bad noise.
No, okay.
But it's just an open question. So your question raises other questions. Yes. It's not a matter of competition, but it's important to know why. It's also a question of money. Who pays the printing costs? And we see the works disappearing as well. So that's just an observation to think about.
Can I add a point to this? This discussion is quite interesting, and it's geared towards... But I mean, there is a problem, which is that we only have access to documentation about a particular kind of agent, right? So missionaries or perhaps merchants, etc., the people who were, in a way, important enough to be documented in letters or in reports. But we should always consider that perhaps the first people to... arriving from Europe over in Asia to function in an Asian language were not documented, right? So this language contact, I think, typically predates anything that we can pinpoint from the documentation, so we should not forget that. And this is particularly obvious for people who do the kind of work that Mario and myself do, because this is the effect of language contact that happens in daily life. That doesn't necessitate a completely fluent knowledge of a foreign language, but a sufficient knowledge of a foreign language to function. So, language contact happens way before, I think, what we find in missionary linguistics, right? So we should perhaps also consider that.
Further questions, remarks? Christina?
If you, when you were saying that it would be interesting to know what was the teaching material, what they teach, and this kind of thing, if you have ever found any information or any mention of the grammar which was used in order to train the Jesuits, that was the Grammatica de Alvarez Latina Portuguesa.
Someone argued of this, but I have to check more. I can reply you later if you like, because someone argued that this was one of the textbooks.
Yeah, because I mean, what I I found out looking at, for example, the school and education in the Jesuit in the India area, that this was the grammar according to which all the Jesuits were trained in order to go and spread the religion and in order to teach further how to spread religion. So, because I think that it would be interesting to reconnect this network of knowledge that today passed from one area to another one in order to...
Yeah, I didn't have the time to touch this point, but one of the ways of reconstruction of the curriculum of São Paulo, among the others, it has been also the comparison with Goa and with the college in Goa. So this is probably one fruitful way to proceed.
And I have one question for Mario, and I don't know if there is there is time. Okay. And I wanted to ask to Hugo, you said that, I mean, these letters gives a picture of the chronology of disappearance, no? Slowly disappearing of Pidgin and Creoles, Portuguese-based Pidgin and Creoles. But did you find some information on the opposite direction? I mean, on how these Pidgin and Creoles spread. We know that they spread through the commerce and whatever, but if they also mentioned that the spreading could be related to other situations, social situations such as school, missionary schools, for example.
Right. Not in this archive, because this is a late 19th century archive, so it documents a particular historical moment when the spread was complete and had happened a long time ago, and it was already on the down, right? You do find information there about languages which were still very vital. Those are not the ones I talked about, but it's also there. But even though these letters, so this particular archive doesn't say anything about how language spread, it is important, these indications are important for us to try and infer how language spread. Because let's say, for example, Burma, right, the southern coast of Burma. If we didn't have these indications, we wouldn't really know to what extent and what type of Portuguese was ever established there, right? With this information, we now have, you know, a historical obligation of trying to find out why it happened, right? So it was kind of a missing link, let's say, because we know a lot about South Asia, we know a lot about Malacca, but then there was this, linguistically speaking, there was this void in the Tenasserim coast. So the fact that we know this, which is not much, now forces us to find the reasons. So this archive doesn't give you the reasons, it gives you the answers. It gives you the questions for it, right? I have found a few references as, for example, why the southern Tenasserim coast would have had these languages, and they have to do with commercial ties, mostly with the Coromandel coast, but also some attempts at, colonizing certain ports in this area, more or less official attempts at sending populations there and military forces there. So there is a history for it, which now has to be uncovered. Yeah. And the same, actually, in fact, the same goes for Flores. The presence of missionaries in Flores is very well documented, right? I think the Dominicans were the ones who established a strong presence there. Of course, we knew that there would have been the presence of the language as well, right? It's not new, so this is not bringing anything new. What it is bringing is kind of concrete information about what type of language it was. And this particular link with Timor in the late 19th century, with people going back and forth for training in Timor, that is new, I think. That's something that wasn't very well documented.
May I just ask Hugo a question in relation to your answer now? Would this presence of Creole languages or communities speaking Creoles in what is today the coast of Burma, would it have anything to do with those communities that were established in the sequence of those mercenaries that went and fought on the side, Portuguese mercenaries, right, that abandoned the crown service and then... It's those communities, is it? Or did they sort of, would they have established them?
Yeah, it probably has to do
to
with
fight
that.
On behalf of the Burmese kings.
That's right.
Against the time. Yeah, okay,
Siamese. It probably has to do with that, but not just with that. Mm-hmm. So that's not the whole story of connections.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm not a historian, I'm not a specialist in this, so this is still an open question. What exactly what were the patterns of population displacement? Everything seems to point at a very close relationship with the Coromandel Coast. On the other hand, from the point of view of a missionary, what you seem to get from these letters is that, at least in the 19th century, Malacca was the center mm-hmm. for the diffusion or mm-hmm. for the control of missionary activities in that area. Mm-hmm. So there, and I don't know to what extent, the connection, the linguistic connection with Malacca could also yeah. be important.
Last question to Mario. You said that among the topics that were presented in the phrase book, you have also body parts and people and things like that. I'm aware that it is a phrasal book, so it means mm-hmm. they are sentences for communication, I mean, how mm-hmm. to deal with communication. But just a curiosity, is there any reference or any description of non-verbal communication? For example, when things are related to body parts, so how to behave physically, which kind?
No, not that I'm aware of yet, but as I say, I haven't had access to the whole phrase book, but not from the examples I have. It's simply, the body parts are simply single names, terms. Even the part that's called dialogues are actually, I was very excited when I saw the title, but then when we started looking at it, and it's not really a dialogue, it's just sentences or very, very short, like questions and answers, but not really a dialogue, so to say. Although the translation from the Chinese would translate it as dialogues for buying and selling.
Yeah, no, I was just curious because, for example, on a dictionary on which I worked and I'm still working, that is a Tamil Portuguese mm-hmm. dictionary, there are some entries which specifically relate how and describe, but it is a dictionary, of course.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's another kind of text, but which describes how, what is the meaning of some expression for eyes and mm-hmm. for expression of the face and interjection and these kind of things. It's
unless
quite
it's
interesting.
In that other part that's missing still. In fact, I didn't mention this, but if this is the compendium or a copy of the compendium that is described by Samuel Wells Williams, then that one has, according to his description, 1,200 entries, and this section that was found has 531. Unless it's in the other 700 that are missing.
And the last thing, thank you to all, because for your relation, they were really, really interesting. I enjoyed them a lot. Thanks.
Are there any other questions? Otherwise, we move to the table if we have questions, cross questions. So, Paolo, please.
A curiosity about the paper of Professor Nunes. When you show the slide about the aspect, mm-hmm. one of your slides, mm-hmm. There was the part in Chinese characters at the top, mm-hmm. and then another other Chinese character that I assume they were just giving the pronunciation in pidgin,
right? I was rushing and I forgot
no,
to
it's
explain
okay.
that.
But one thing that I just, maybe mm-hmm. I'm ignorant of pidgin, but in the Chinese, you were saying that there was the presence of aspectual markers. Mm-hmm. I would like to ask if you took into your consideration the Chinese part of the example, mm-hmm. or the pidgin part?
No, I took into consideration the transliteration.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
If I can, just a very little to Professor Pinyananda Nunes, is just a curiosity of coming from my ignorance, is if these very interesting phrase books that were produced in Macau have also precedents or something that we can call in mm-hmm. this way in the context of in the Asian context related to
perhaps
the.
Perhaps Hugo will be able to reply better than me, but actually one point is
they had from when more mm-hmm. or less?
Well, first of all, these were actually published in Canton.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
After the establishment of the first printing Western printing house there,
which was actually by the British. No, Southeast Asia, not that I know of, unless Goa or Sri Lanka has something, definitely. But I can't think of the setting of Malacca, for example, or any other situation there in Southeast Asia that I know of, no. But I suppose since the presence was more stable in India, they would have something.
The only thing I can think of is a little different. Mm-hmm. And it's from Sri Lanka, so it's a little—it's a little later from, than this.
I didn't mention Sri Lanka because it's later. Yeah. I thought of that.
From the early 19th century, mm-hmm. you have not necessarily just these small kind of portable phrase books like what you find in the Pearl River Delta, but you have some kind of guidebook and little dialogues included in grammars. So from the early 19th century, you have grammars of Sri Lanka Portuguese or Ceylon Portuguese at the time, which have a description, right? But then they also have a section with questions and answers, you know, to help people start speaking the language and functioning in the language. So it's a slightly different setting.
Yeah.
I don't know of anything similar in other contexts, no.
But it's very, very interesting looking as a kind of source of this context.
But then if we still consider the 19th century in Sri Lanka, I think that later even, we have those, the newspapers, the Brufador, and all those pamphlets and things.
Right, but those aren't necessarily
those are, no, yeah, they're
phrase
more,
books, they're just
no,
you know,
definitely, the
regular publications for daily life consumption. In Sri Lanka, you have a lot. In Ceylon, you had a lot. But this is not replicated in any other Asian context that I know of when it comes to Creoles.
Thank you. Well, I think that it's 1 o'clock, so it's time for lunch, and so we can stop here now. Thank you very much for this morning, and we meet here again at 2:30 for the second session of this day. Thank you.